We are all, we can start. Well, welcome to everybody. It's very nice to see so many of you. We have arranged for today a very interesting seminar on L1 adaptive control theory and applications. A lot of the theory will be distributed to you by the person who has, in collaboration with the colleagues, invented the theory, Professor Naira Hovakimyan from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. I would like, first of all, to welcome and thank Naira to join us today here. It's been long traveling all the way from US, a very tight schedule. Hopefully, she will manage to go back with a satisfactory visit here in Denmark. I would like also to welcome AU Special Consultant Jussi Hermansen for bringing some cool toy here today to show how the theory can get into practice and can be applied for several applications in the area of unmanned vehicles that nowadays, as we know, is a very hot topic for several industries. Certainly, again, welcome to all of you. It's impressive to see how many you are. And I would also like to thank you, the guys in Jutland at Vestas Wind Systems and at Danfoss, that they are following us remotely through the web connection. Last but not least, I would like to thank you, IEEE Denmark, that has supported me in organizing this event. And in particular, I would like to thank you, Professor Thomas Pack from University of Aalborg, that is Vice Chair of the Control System Society and Automation Society at IEEE Denmark, for actually doing some physical work for me in order to arrange this seminar. So what is the, I think I forgot to tell who I am. That must be because many of you know me, but maybe somebody doesn't. My name is Roberto Galeazzi. I'm assistant professor at the Automation and Control Group at DTU Electrical Engineering, and I'm obviously the host of this event. We miss a spring on the door. Well, let's move forward. The program of the day, we have, as I said, a very interesting seminar, quite a few events going on. We will start, hopefully on time, with the keynote lecture by Professor Naira Hovakimyan. And the title of the lecture is L1 Adaptive Control and its Transition to Practice. I'm sure Naira will impress us with the many interesting things that in the last 5 to 6 years, if I'm correct, she managed to develop with her own group at the University of Illinois in this outbreaking area of adaptive control. Then we will have a short coffee break, certainly time for questions, and the first occasion to mingle among each other and with Professor Hovakimyan if you have some interesting questions to address. I have been asked to remind all of us that the coffee break will take place upstairs, because downstairs it's occupied by the students and we can't kick them out of the building. Then we will move on with a live demo right in front of the building. Outside, UAV specialist, special consultant Jussi Hermansen will operate one of the multi-rotor copters that is producing with his own company, where an L1 adaptive flight controller is implemented, so we could see the capabilities of this novel autopilot put into practice. After that, we will have a couple of short presentations, one by myself and another one by one of our PhD candidates, Lukas, Theisen, about our experience here in Denmark with L1 adaptive control in collaboration with the Danish Navy, that is always a very good supplier of fancy toys for us at the department. We will have some closing remarks, and then we will have a light refreshment again upstairs, where we will have a longer time to chit-chat, mingle among each other, and get to know Professor Hovakimyan much better. So take these two chances after the lecture and at the end to socialize and get something useful out of the seminar, besides, of course, all the knowledge that you will bring back home, hopefully. So let's give the proper welcoming. We will start with this keynote lecture on L1 adaptive control and its transition to practice. Professor Hovakimyan received her PhD in physics and mathematics in 1992, as we can see here, in Moscow from the Institute of Applied Mathematics of Russian Academy of Sciences, majoring in optimal control and differential games. In 1997, she has been awarded a governmental postdoctoral scholarship to work at, in RIA in France. In 1998, she joined as a research faculty member, Georgia Tech, where she has been working until 2003. In 2003, she moves again, becoming associate professor at Virginia Tech. And from then, in 2008, she has joined as a full professor, University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, where beside being professor, is also university scholar and Schaller faculty scholar of mechanical science and engineering. The numbers, I believe, talks for on her behalf. More than 300 referee publications, 3,000 citations, more than that, and what is by now the only, but certainly the very famous book on L1 adaptive control theory. Naira, she's an associate fellow and life member of several associations, among others AIAA, and senior member of IEEE, member of SIAM, and others. Her research interests are in theory of robust adaptive control and estimation, control in the presence of limited information, networks of autonomous systems, game theory, and application of those in safety critical system of aerospace, mechanical, electrical, petroleum, and biomedical engineering. So we have, I'm pleased to say that today we are with us, we have an excellent scientist that has proven to be so. So please, let's give a warm welcome to Professor Hovakimyan and let's enjoy her talk. If we can manage to make it so.
Okay. Oh, yeah, that was right.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So I want to thank Roberto for invitation and for hosting me here. I want to thank for the very warm reception that I had the pleasure to enjoy over the past 2 days. And let's hope that within the next hour I will keep you enough entertained so you won't get a chance to feel that I'm jet lagged. So I'll talk about the L1 adaptive control that we developed over the last few years, since 2004, and some of the exciting transitions into various applications that we were able to deliver over the last few years. So L1 adaptive control, let me start from just introducing that it's not about any new mathematics per se, but it's about a new class of architectures that we were able to put together to address various issues that adaptive control has experienced over the past 50 years of history. So what you see here are Lyapunov and Zems. I'm sure that you know both of them from various control courses, textbooks. So Lyapunov is famous for stability theory, although I should say that stability theory was maybe his master thesis, and his most of his career was dedicated to probability theory. And Zems is known for the input-output stability theory. In the context of L1 adaptive architectures, we'll refer to the stability theory for derivation of the adaptive laws, estimation laws, while we will refer to input-output stability theory for the proofs of stability. That helps us to get certain guarantees on robustness. So moving ahead, okay. So now I know how to operate this. So I'll start from a historical overview of adaptive control, highlight the key issues that motivated the development of this class of architectures, in the context of which I will clarify the role of adaptation, performance, and robustness. So with the class of architectures that we put forth, we separate adaptation from robustness. And that helps us to claim that in some sense we can develop a new class of feedback controllers for which the verification and validation challenges can be addressed in a systematic way. And the NASA flight tests of a piloted aircraft with all the pilots' audio is what will make the presentation exciting, I'm sure, for many of you. So moving forward, so the development of adaptive control was motivated in mid-50s with NASA's X-15 major flight test program that until now remains to be one of the most successful flight test programs at NASA. So by then it was clear that a fixed gain controller could not suffice for the entire envelope and one needed a mechanism for parametric adjustment to adjust the controller parameters to capture the wide variation of uncertainties across a large envelope. So the first rules that appeared in literature were known as MIT rule and sensitivity rule. Nevertheless, Rudolf Kalman was the first one who coined the term adaptive control by considering optimal LQR with explicit identification of parameters. So NASA completed 199 flights between 1959 and 1968, one of which ended up with a crash. So this crash, as it was found out later, was due to the adaptive control system on board that led the controller into saturation, into parameter drift, control saturation, and ended up being responsible for the death of the pilot, Michael Adams. In a later paper in 1985, Carl Astrom refers to this era as a brave era, implying that there was a very short path from theory to practice. I can assure you that if today you try to crash an aircraft this way, it won't happen. So that was basically a proof of a very naive understanding of robustness issues in that time. This crash led to a lot of excitement among the theoreticians to explore the stability proofs, robustness issues in these adaptive control systems. So the first major proofs go back to 70s, 80s. Robustness issues were seriously challenged in mid-80s with the famous Rohr's example. Many of you may have heard the name. A lot of tricks for modification of the parametric estimation laws appeared in 80s, shaping the so-called field of robust adaptive control. Nonlinear methods were largely addressed in 90s, including the famous neurofuzzy methods that were also flight tested on some of the aerospace applications I'll mention briefly later. So nevertheless, the end of the 20th century had witnessed the fact that for addressing rapid variation of uncertainties, the adaptive control architectures had a certain type of limitation. And to capture broader variation of uncertainties, people started looking into multiple models, search methods, switching techniques, the performance of which was eventually reduced to the frequency of switching, and with that, it was limited by the opportunities that could handle large variations of uncertainties. So this historical development led to landmark achievement. Exactly 30 years after that historical crash, United States Air Force jointly with the Boeing Company successfully flight tested the X-36 tailless unstable aircraft with an adaptive controller on board. So this flight test demonstrated that adaptive control can handle the unknown knowledge of the aerodynamic coefficients, which can provide wind tunnel savings on the range of $8 to $10 million for a commercial aircraft at Boeing. Nevertheless, they also pointed the limitations of adaptive control methods in a sense that, again, to capture the large variation of uncertainties, one needed to increase the adaptive gain, but increasing adaptive gain was leading to oscillations, high-frequency oscillations in input-output channels. So there was a limited tolerance to time delays, and finding the best adaptation gain was possible only by resorting to Monte Carlo runs for a few months. So basically, if on one end one was saving on wind tunnel tests, on the other end one had to pay the price for software complexity because there was no systematic way of tuning the adaptive controller for various adaptive gains. In particular, for example, the JDAM application, to the best of my knowledge, has 500 gain schedule points, and it means that the baseline controller that gets augmented with the adaptive loop, so the adaptive loop has a new adaptive gain for every gain scheduled control point. So if from the perspective of aerodynamics, it makes sense to gain schedule according to the altitude, Mach number, and other major parameters, then from the perspective of adaptive control design, one wants to have a uniform adaptive controller that would adapt to all the conditions without the need to schedule it. So these questions motivated the design of L1 adaptive controllers. So I like to call it a Boeing question because this is how the problem was formulated for me by my collaborators from Boeing. How fast to adapt to be robust? Roughly saying, how slow is slow? How fast is fast? Where is that analytical boundary between slow variation of uncertainty, fast variation of uncertainty, and so on? So L1 adaptive control architectures offer a class of architectures in which, by means of the architecture, the estimation loop is decoupled from the control loop. That helps to increase the estimation rates arbitrarily without hurting robustness of the system. And it helps also to get guaranteed transient performance without resorting to gain scheduling, control reconfiguration, and without going for persistent sieve excitation, which was known to be the main tool to achieve transient response guarantees with conventional adaptive schemes. So we can prove that the performance limitations are reduced to hardware limitations in a sense that given the control channel bandwidth and the CPU, one can quantify the performance dependence upon these parameters of the system. We also get uniform scale transient response dependent upon the changes in initial conditions in the unknown parameters and reference inputs. With that, we argue that we can have a theoretically justified framework for verification and validation of feedback systems. So let's see where was the black cat hidden. So if we take the simplest problem formulation for which adaptive control was conceived and developed, so we'll see that so the parametric uncertainties for here, for this simple case, are kind of appearing in a matched fashion, right? So the conventional adaptive control starts from considering the nominal controller that would compensate perfectly for the uncertainties in case of perfect knowledge of those and replace those by the desired feed forward leading to the desired feed system behavior. So in this system, so AM is basically Hurwitz matrix, KG would be the feed forward gain, R would be the desired reference input. So if on this slide, there will be no estimation, no uncertainty. Let's assume that now that the parametric structure for which one is aiming for complete compensation and replacing it by the desired feedforward has frequencies in it that lie outside the control channel bandwidth or has amplitudes that you cannot capture by your actuator models and so on. Then naturally, your desired objective won't be achieved. It is true that the mathematical substitution of this feedback structure into the original system will lead to this system. Mathematically, it's clean. But when you go for real-world implementation, even if you know theta perfectly, but its behavior is unacceptable for your implementation, you may only get part of uncertainties compensated and not complete. So what we did, basically, we questioned that this problem of formulation may be overly ambitious. So instead, we said we'll be less ambitious. We will only aim for compensation of uncertainties within a low-pass filter, within the control channel bandwidth. And with that, we understood that the resulting behavior won't be ideal, clean, and nice like this, but we may have some presence of uncertainties, requiring that this system, to be a well-defined control objective, needs its separate stability proof. And the stability proof can be deduced from that input-output stability theorem, small gain theorem-like result, saying that if CS is chosen so that the L1 norm of this cascaded system is less than 1 divided by L, where this capital letter L is the Lipschitz constant of the uncertainty, in this case it can be viewed like the 1 norm of theta, then the state of this reference system will remain bounded. If the state is bounded, then it can be considered as a control objective. It's another thing that it still depends upon uncertainties, and one needs to resort to additional techniques to quantify its performance in the presence of uncertainties. But once it's stable, it can serve as a control objective. So with this, we decouple the estimation from control, and which helps us already to increase the estimation rates without losing robustness. So to move forward, so it's kind of good when you're changing the problem formulation to find other facts that support your claims. So adaptive control has raised a lot of red flags in the literature, among which I would like to bring the following two quotes, especially the first one. So these are quotes by Brian Anderson from a famous paper, Failures of Adaptive Control Theory, published in 2005 in a special issue dedicated to Thomas Kailat's 70th birthday, where he specifically writes, having a flag in an adaptive control algorithm to indicate the inappropriateness of an originally posed objective is practically important and missing from the older adaptive control literature. Logic really demands it. If a plant is initially unknown or only partially known, a designer may not know a priori whether the proposed control objective is or is not achievable for the plant. This is exactly in line with our observation that the originally proposed control objective may not be achievable. Further, in the same paper, he offers a remedy. It is clear that the identification timescale needs to be faster than the plant variation timescale, else identification cannot keep up. It also turns out that it is harder to develop good adaptive controllers which identify at a timescale comparable with that of a closed-loop dynamics. Interaction of the two processes can occur and generate instability. This is exactly what happened in the 1967 crash. So moving forward, so we kind of revisited the literature to see what was the origin of adaptive control. How did it start? So the first solutions that were proposed yet in the 60s so captured two parallel paradigms. One was known like indirect method, the other direct method. In the indirect method, people were attempting at first to do system identification, kind of to estimate the parameters and then use them in a controller. In the direct method, people were attempting directly to estimate the control parameters. However, in late 70s, Bo Egart, a student of Karl Astrom, and I believe also Lena Valavani in United States, were able to prove that these stability proofs appear to be equivalent. One can be reduced to another. And with that understanding, it was clear that if one answers the robustness questions in one setting, then the same answers will apply in the other setting because robustness is just a measure of stability. So with that understanding, the indirect method got less attention in future papers because the direct method was easier in some sense to implement. And the further developments were based on the direct method and its various architectures. Nevertheless, the L1 type modification was possible to do with the indirect method and not with the direct method. Why? So that's an architectural point. This is what I emphasized in the beginning, that here we talk more about new architectures, how to put things together and to modify an architecture. So this method was suitable while this one not. Why? Here it is. So if we look into the direct architecture, what we see is that the system state gets subtracted from the desired reference system state to form an error signal which is used to update the parametric estimates for the direct feedback controller. In the indirect method, what happens, the system has its model running in parallel and the difference between the two, the error signal is again used for parametric estimation to provide the parametric estimate to the feedback controller, which goes as input to both systems. The system and its parallel model, which was in literature known by few names like passive identifier, companion model, state predictor, and so on. We choose the name state predictor. So what's the difference? Mathematically, if you substitute this controller here, you get exactly what stands here without any difference. But here is where mathematics and engineering are different, because if I want to modify, for example, the above architecture by inserting a low-pass filter here to appropriately band the control frequencies for robustness specifications, it would be impossible because at the output it will destroy the structure of the error dynamics. A low-pass filter will lead to a higher dimension in this line, generating here a signal of higher dimension which would not be subtractable from the original low-dimensional reference system. Once the structure of the error dynamics is destroyed, the Lyapunov proof that generates the estimation law and the corresponding feedback signal lose its meaning. In the other case, it is just the opposite. So I can easily insert a low-pass filter here, and because the error dynamics here is independent of the control signal, because the control signal goes to both models in the same way with the same sign, so in the difference it's always cancelled out, no matter it's low-pass filtered or without the low-pass filter. It's a signal that gets cancelled out without destroying the structure of the error dynamics. Hence, the original estimation law that was coming out from the Lyapunov analysis retains its form without losing its meaning. And that's nice because this estimation law is nothing else but gradient minimization born algorithm. So it has some nice features to it. And the low-pass filtered signal now goes to both systems. The only difference is that in this case now we have to prove the stability of this system. If in this case this was guaranteed, here it's not guaranteed. Now we have to figure out conditions on the filter that would retain stability of this. Moreover, in the top case, this was the desired reference system with the desired specifications. So if we had it here given, here we have to look for a new reference system because this is already a nonlinear system for which the rise time, settling time, and overshoot have to be kind of redefined. So moving forward, so at first, stability proof. So looking into this closed loop architecture, we see that recasting it into frequency domain structure, we would find that these signals here are bounded and the rest falls into the hands of the small gain theorem type argument, which basically says if the L1 norm of the cascaded system is bounded, then Barbala lemma can be applied to prove asymptotic convergence of the tracking error to zero. This basically says that by insertion of the filter, we did not lose the asymptotic tracking that was coming with the conventional adaptive controller, but we have to prove additional properties. And namely, as I said, we have to look for a reference system to quantify the transients. So at first, we compare the signals of this closed-loop architecture with the signals of that control objective that I put on the prior slide, the ideal model kind of without the filter. So we see that the difference of the two signals can be found to be inverse proportional to the adaptive gain. And the new thing here is the control bound, which doesn't exist in the prior adaptive control methods. So the beauty of this bound is that what you see here in the denominator is a strictly proper system. By having CS here, we ensure that this system is at least proper, having a bounded L1 norm. In the absence of CS, this would be an improper filter leading to unbounded gamma 2, agreeing with the fact that the conventional adaptive control in the presence of fast estimation rates has no guarantees for its control bound. So noticing that the given norms are in L infinity, so we have the responsibility to prove the dependence upon the non-zero trajectory initialization errors. And one can prove that in the presence of non-zero trajectory initialization errors, we get here additional terms which are exponentially decaying, so dependent upon the initialization error, again giving us an opportunity to quantify the transient performance. So with fast estimation rates, we approximate the signals of this system, which partially depends upon the uncertainty, as we see, because CS will only compensate for part of it. So then there is a question, what should be our reference system for performance specifications, rise time, settling time, overshoot? And for that, we consider an additional system where we will have the filter inside the system to clean the output of any uncertainties so that the design specifications can be enforced on this cascaded system. Basically, CS slows down the system response and we have to reflect that understanding. Now we have the responsibility to compute the bounds between the two systems. And if we compute the bounds, we find that these bounds are proportional to lambda, where lambda is what we needed to be less than 1. For the proof of stability, now we see that to get the best performance, one needs to minimize lambda. One may obviously say, just take out the CS, then you get the zero. But that, in that case, we know we lose the control bound. So we'll get to that later. So the performance bounds are now decoupled into two terms. So with fast estimation rates, we approximate the signals of a linear reference system that ensures scaling, all the properties we would like to have. And by tuning of lambda, right, with the help of the filter design, we can achieve the desired response given by widest T. So the performance bounds are decoupled into two terms. And noticing that gamma C, the adaptation rate, needs to be high. So we have to have an explanation for the practitioners who come and say that sensor and control sampling are done at a very low rate. We don't have the opportunity to sample those at the rates that you ask. And naturally, they can be sampled at a low rate, and the fast CPU is needed only for implementation of the estimation laws. And for the time delay margin, so we prove that in the presence of the L1 norm condition, the time delay margin of the closed-loop adaptive system has a guaranteed lower bound provided by the LTI system of the following form. Here, H bar s is the original system, theta is the uncertainty, and as we notice, the CS here is also completely decoupled. The fact that the CS is decoupled helps to tune the time delay margin accordingly, so in a systematic way, right? While the performance bounds are guaranteed by the adaptation rate. So with that, I would like to kind of move forward and just give a brief overview of what happens in case if the system gain is unknown. In case if B is unknown, this is just a scalar example to illustrate that things are not always as simple as I put here until this point. So if we have to estimate also the unknown input gain, then it's not just about putting a low-pass filter. It won't work, but there is a feedback loop that one has to synthesize to obtain the control signal and to provide it to both systems. I say this because quite often we see papers when people take their adaptive controllers and they try to do this straightforward modification at the filter without understanding that their input gain is unknown, and one has to be more careful in these cases. So further extensions of the theory, which I am now skipping, including nonlinear uncertainties, unmodeled dynamics, unmeshed uncertainties, output feedback, SPR systems, non-SPR systems, and so on, are summarized in the book. And there is twice the volume of the book of papers that were not included in the book. In case of any questions, feel free to email me. So this slide just gives a brief overview of the aerospace applications that we've addressed over the years. Some of them were simulation models, some of them were flown. So what was flown has a red kind of perimeter here. So these are the small UAVs that the Naval Postgraduate School has been flying in Camp Roberts. And for these systems, we have done augmentation of the off-the-shelf autopilots. So these Rascal UAVs come with autopilots off-the-shelf. So we augmented them with L1 to handle various uncertainties, failures, and so on. And these are the flight tests of NASA. So what you see here is a subscale generic transport model aircraft. I'm not allowed to spell out which model it is, but you can Google and find. So unfortunately, that's the situation. So let's go ahead and see what were the challenges there. So in 2007, NASA came along with this program, Aviation Safety, putting this picture on the first page that shows basically the safety envelope in terms of angle of attack and the angle of side slip. What's here in green is the normal flight envelope that the airplane usually flies. What's gray corresponds to the area for which there is enough aerodynamic data and they can do modeling. And blue corresponds to the area for which NASA does not have models. Models are not available, and it is not even clear if the aircraft is controllable in any of these blue configurations. Okay, blue corresponds to highly tilted aircraft and rotated, so trust me, if your aircraft appears in blue, you might be screaming and praying already, and you don't want to be there. So basically, you start flying in green, and if a failure happens, imagine it's flying at the speed of 80 knots, right? A failure happens, that's a super fast system. You may instantaneously appear in the blue, right? This means that what NASA was interested in finding control systems that would react sufficiently fast within the first 2-4 seconds, because if it hits the blue, then there are no guarantees. In gray, there are still some guarantees. So to bring it back to the green. So they were interested in a flight control system with predictable response and with transient guarantees. So here is where the fun part starts. So this small model aircraft, which is $2 million, was given as an experimental platform to 24 groups in the country. So we could go and put the controller there and test. So it's a subscale aircraft. NASA was very keen about this subscaling process. It took them, I think, 5 years to build it. They were so keen that they did not want to even to use a small computer board on this aircraft because it would have violated their mass scaling properties. So they were very rigorous about this experiment. Now I'll go show how they were doing this experiment. So the pilot is sitting inside this truck. NASA calls this flying wind tunnel. Why? Because if you want to go on the bigger Boeing aircraft, for example, and try a new controller, naturally there are FAA regulations. Boeing would not let its passenger safety, aviation safety, pilot safety, everything. So the way Boeing tries is the wind tunnel and then the aircraft, right? So there is nothing in between. So when NASA built this facility, they called it flying wind tunnel. So the pilot sits inside the truck. Here is the antenna that wirelessly communicates the control signals to this subscale airplane. The pilot flies as if he flies the natural one. There is the system ID room and the guest room. This is our room where we usually could sit if we want to be inside. But we get the muted headsets. We are not allowed to talk, but we can listen to the entire conversation. Here you see Chengyu and Endrik. Chengyu, I call the godfather of L1 adaptive control. He was the postdoctoral fellow in my group when we started this development, and I give him a lot of credit, if not all the credit, for all the hard work that went into it. Endrik was my PhD student. Now he is the postdoc who did all these flight tests and worked with NASA day and night with pilots and everything, sometimes just sleeping 2 hours during the deployments, because these deployments start 6 a.m., they go till 8 p.m., they get back with flight data, Henry goes and works till 2 a.m., then up 4 a.m., going to the field to start at 6 a.m. and so on. So I give him all the credit. I give the guys all the credit for doing the work. All the mistakes are mine. Put it that way. So let's go ahead and see just one flight test as fun to take a break kind of in the middle of the presentation. So this is how it goes. So they start here refueling. So they go to the runway. You will soon see in a second it will be on the runway waiting to take off. So they have a safety pilot who takes off. It remains within this deployment. The airplane was supposed to remain within the visual range of the pilot, so he can take over any minute the new control algorithm fails. So here he is. Here is our baby, so we liked him very much, this aircraft. See the Boeing sound? I believe I can even make our sound here larger, right? We have room to make it. So there is a big crew working besides the pilot and the flight test engineers who are in the truck. There is also outside crew. And now you'll have the opportunity to see what is the mission of each of these people. So the safety pilot takes off and passes the control to the research pilot. The pilots that worked with us are retired Boeing pilots, and they have like a long number of years of testing research control laws. They talk very much our language. They come and say, oh, we want more damping in short period, or we want, and depend in between four pilots, you get 10 different opinions. So that's the challenge of working with human systems, okay? Then you appreciate the autonomy. How nice it is to be. Here is the pilot, so he's flying. He has one screen for looking at the airplane, the other, the flight test engineer next to him is capable of injecting the failures. So it's built as a research aircraft. One can manually inject failures. So and here the failures that were tried are 5 millisecond delays added every 5 seconds. So checking for the latency fault, so controller's tolerance to time delays. And then now we get back to the control room to see what is the system ID group doing. They are continuously recording data for system identification, for updating the models at the departure edges. So we have flight cards that are being flown. These are system identification people, Jim Morelli. So they're recording the flight data to update the models for those failure conditions that we are kind of being tested against. And here is the outside crew. So this is the safety pilot with some assistant. So they are basically always in control. If something goes wrong, they can take over. It's a new control law. And these are people who are reading the data, altitude sensors and so on, and it's all connected to the research pilot and everything. It's about 20 people working for 2 weeks in every deployment. So these experiments are really very, very expensive for NASA to run. So we were happy just to get the opportunity to test our theory as much as we wanted. So these are typical flight cards, for example, where you see, so whatever is blacked out are the numbers we are all not supposed to see. So NASA was sending us some fake models to design the flight controllers. We're doing batch simulations. And then we're going there, putting the controller onto real system without ever having the opportunity to see the real aerodynamic data, which was obtained, I believe, from the company. So we see here like the small inputs. You see, I mean, the steps, the changes were very conservative. Every flight was planned according to flight cards, and there was no opportunity to change any of the flight cards during the flight. So the process was extremely rigorous. So NASA's challenge was to fly the aircraft into stall and post-stall and to check the handling quality. So here is one flight where the pilots went to... where should I click out here? So where the pilots went into stall and post-stall without L1, flight 25, okay? In flight 23, L1 was used. So I want to stop here and to briefly comment on this before I go ahead. So flight 23, they used the L1 controller. It handled pretty well. What I admired about NASA program that they were pushing all of us to our limits, not just us, like the pilots, right? In flight 23, they tried, they handled it. Flight 25, you go without L1. See if you have learned something that you can apply to avoid the need for any advanced control. It's like first week winter in Illinois, where I had no driving experience on ice. I had 2 car accidents, okay? Then I learned how to handle my car on ice, and ever since then, I never had a car accident. But first time, I didn't know how to handle it. It was braking, it was sliding even more. I was braking even more harshly, then I was having an accident. 1, 2, then I learned, right? So what they were trying to do, okay, here is the controller, you learn, now go and do without controller. So if the pilots were managing to do it without us, then they would come back to us with a more challenge. Go and handle this, go and handle that. So it was kind of extremely challenging, but also extremely rewarding. It's very exciting to be a part of it. So I'm kind of happy we have that mileage on our back. It makes us stronger. So they go here into, this will be your stall indicator. Above 12 degrees angle of attack, it will turn red, indicating that the aircraft goes into stall. The speeds drop from 80 to 40. We'll see the time histories later. So and they try different strategies. One, gone. It's gone. So and then they try the second. So and if you tune to listen to their conversation, you'll see, let's try faster this time. It's like you pull your car over an icy mountain. You are not able to pull, you go back, you try faster, you try slower, different strategies. This is what they exercise. Now you will see they lose it again. They go into the third attempt, and if I stop talking, you will listen. They will say, let's try faster this time. So they're exercising different attempts. And now the third attempt, they're trying just different strategies to see which would help them to do it without any controller. Okay. So it failed, right? So this is the flight 23 now, where it went into high angle of attack. So this flight was not designed specifically for postal experiment. It was designed for other purposes, other failures like latency, degradation of aerodynamic coefficients, and so on. But they decided to check also stolen postal. And towards the end of the flight, they did two maneuvers, and then they ran out of fuel. So this is like the first flight I like to show this. My students like to show already the remaining flights where they did challenging maneuvers in postal. So here it shows where the speeds dropped below 50, indicating the postal nature of the flight. And here is the flight itself. So and you listen to again pilot's audio, how easy they do it. So the pilot goes into 18 degree angle of attack capture task, and then the engineer asks him, do you want to come back? He says, oh yeah, easy, so sure. So the confidence of pilot in terms of controlling the aircraft is just very well emphasized in this audio. And the pilots don't know what are they flying. For them, the controllers have numbers. Controller 3.6, controller 3.2. So there is no way of bribing the pilot. So they are just kind of... So 18 degree angle of attack is the capture task. So they come to the initial condition. So that was like setting up the initial condition. They fly in patterns of 8, the kind of a trajectory specified in that flyable zone. And then they go to 18, you see how it shakes, but it survives, and then you see the drop of the altitude and the velocity, so. You ready? Yeah, yeah, okay, no problem for him. So the pilots were very confident with this. And now it does the second attempt. And repeat is important to check the performance specifications so that being 10 times stable with different transients doesn't count for them. They want same transients to prove it for further. If they go there now with a different transient, they would discard it. So they won't count it. So they would say, oh, once it happened, okay? So and again, they survived it. And here is the fuel land, so they have to come down. Now it turns red. So, okay, it beeps, okay. Bingo. Let's stop research. So two times going into postal, you see that the trajectory in alpha phi is very similar, so which means repeatable results, like commented by NASA. These slides are by NASA, so well-controllable aircraft by the pilot. So. Going further, so this is one of NASA's favorite charts where they go for 125 cm alpha CLP degradation, and when the aircraft is kind of completely unstable, so it's a completely wrong model. So they had the opportunity to shift these things. So the pilot calls knock it off but did not abandon the control law. The pilot can call knock it off, abandon the control law, and go back to baseline or go back to pilot to stick. But he was confident about the control law. He abandoned, he just abandoned the failure, so very quickly, within less than 10 seconds, he was able to catch up. So we check this alpha beta plots every time, not we, but NASA checks, okay, so we were well in green. With their attempts, they went into blue. So these are some modeling tasks that they were interested to pursue in postal regimes, like they call it angle of attack, alpha vane calibration, then they have side slip calibration. So variable angle of attack strategy, holding the aircraft at stall condition, which is a lot more challenging than flying through it, they said. Here also they hold it at stall pretty long. They do Schroeder sweeps for system identification. As I said, the modeling group works to do system ID for departure edges of the flight envelope and various tasks. So these are step inputs. And these are the movies that my students like to show, but I haven't linked them here. So this doing flat turns is very challenging. As you see, it's 0 degree in side slip angle. So then this was the side slip vane calibration. Exploring the departure edges of the flight envelope. So they go up to the limits of controllability, okay? If you know your aircraft controllability limits, say they know these limits from wind tunnel tests, they were anxious to check whether one controller would suffice for the entire limbs. Like, you know, AB controllability check to do, you know it's controllable for all these positions. Would one controller suffice for all? And this is what they checked, and basically here is how they go into the limits of controllability. So up to 28 degree angle of attack, and what you see, so they start again introducing the Schroeder sweeps so that to excite the aircraft for system identification purposes. There is an objective to recover the departure edge, to get models of the departure edge. They come to 28 degree in angle of attack. You see the aircraft starts already dancing from 25 on. So, and eventually they lose it at 28 degree angle of attack. And this result was repeated in the last 9 flights, I believe, every time they got convergent results with the same. So here is from 750 seconds to 770, so 20 seconds, it has been in going through the stall and post-stall. This part is already a slow pull. They pull it very slowly for, and they see that they were able to hold the aircraft pretty long till it eventually goes in stability. So these are high workload tasks, which are in which case pilot is accidentally given a runway, say, and he has to quickly land, because if he misses by a second, he will be short of the runway to land. We can just see a few shots here, because this is a longer movie. And they give always these Cooper Harper ratings for every flight. We get this handling qualities rating, flying qualities rating. So the pilot is accidentally given a runway, and he has to do rapid turn right, left, and come and land. If he misses by a second, he'll be short of the runway. This is called high workload task, and this they are doing for pilots' fatigue and so on. Different human factors type of research gets coupled in. So then they go for L1 and they get kind of better ratings. So they do different failures and go forward. So here are the ratings. This is stick to surface and this is L1 adaptive flight controls. For the nominal, they had level 1 handling qualities. This is when your airplane flies smooth, you have no fastened seatbelt sign and so on. When they go to neutral stability, it drops to level 2, and then for non-stable aircraft, we drop to level 3. So this is the NASA summary chart. Let's see what do they have as their main accomplishments. So in this program, all the other controllers that entered the competition had a baseline augmented with some type of adaptive or robust controller. Because this aircraft was an open platform given to us, we refused to put a baseline, not that that's the right way to do flight control. No, today we are doing baseline plus L1. But because we wanted to check the limits of the theory and we were given the opportunity to do so, we took out the baseline, we just put L1 to test the theory. We know then everything is achieved due to this controller. So we, with a single controller that was designed around the nominal flight condition, 4 degree angle of attack, 80 knot speed flight condition, we were able to go up to 28 degree angle of attack, 8 degrees inside slip, and this was the only controller at NASA cleared for high angle of attack flights by the pilots. All the other controllers that were in the competition, so we know that 9 of them reached the flight testing, others did not reach, ended up in simulations. And among the 9 controllers, only this one, the pilot took into high angle of attack. For all the other controllers, they shut it down, I think, after 5 degree angle of attack. If I'm wrong with that, that would be small deviation only. For high workload tasks that I just now showed, they were able to fly all the 9 controllers, okay? Because those high workload tasks with offset landings, they were not going into high angle of attack, okay? So it appears that going into high angle of attack, handling in post-stall, was the most challenging task, and L1 was the only one surviving there. So predictable response to the pilot, graceful degradation, predictable degradation of the performance, controllable aircraft always safe return to normal flight envelope. And a lot of modeling work was done in postal flight regimes. Expanding the aerodynamic envelope up to 28 degree angle of attack was something they did not expect. With one single controller designed at 4 degree angle of attack, they were able to go up to 28. They didn't believe, we didn't believe either, but it happened, so. And they were able to execute basically the entire flight envelope with a single maneuver without kind of breaking it down into several parts. What's next at NASA, right? After all that, so we have naturally continuation of the program. So very rigorous experimentation from 5.5% model, the next we are allowed is a 15% model. And hopefully within the next 2 years, they will fly this 15% model. But in the meantime, we have the full-scale model available for simulator testing purposes. So we are right now redesigning the controller for the full-scale, which will for now live in their simulators. And for simulation purposes, the 15% model we will hopefully soon fly. And moreover, we have also unconventional aircraft configurations. This one has three flight modes, vertical takeoff and landing, transition to hover. And they hope to fly this in December. Obviously, by December, we won't have L1. We'll have a baseline there to fly because we just got the model last week. And there's a lot of work to do there. So, and then we have this BAT-4 model, which is also an unconventional aircraft configuration, which is scheduled to fly in March. So we are a little bit easier here in terms of deadlines. So these are other aircraft in Europe. Some are provided by Jussi. These are already the fun things. So Cessna Citation is what we have at Technical University of Delft. So for the Simona simulator we are trying. I know that Saab is writing papers using their Gripen model. When will they try? I don't know. This is in Technical University of Munich. This is also doing something with Munich. I cannot talk about the model, but they can maybe if they want. This is also Munich. Technical University of Munich has three models. We are working with them. This is the hexarotor that you see there. Hopefully it will fly. Jussi will help us to see how it's flying, right? And I will show just this, this one from Technical University of Munich because this is fun. So they have a baseline controller on their quadrotor and they have done this cute experiment. Look how they show what is L1 doing. It's a good baseline, pretty good. 500-pound platform, they hang, I don't know how big was this tape, maybe 200, so it goes back. Now they add L1 and they repeat the experiment. It's a nice way of demonstrating what they have done. Now L1 is switched on and they put, it's on the top of baseline, of course, and you see no movement, okay? This is what Technical University Munich did. We are not a part of this paper. We did not help them. I saw their YouTube channel, so it was kind of cute to see. And I don't know if Jussi will show this, but this is also one of Jussi's movies, right? So this is video capturing, right? Video testing. So he's flying in quite a bit of winds. And this just shows stable photography taken with these platforms that's here. So this one doesn't have the camera, but here the one is with the camera. So, and now you will see the wind parameters coming here. It's 10 to 12 meter per second wind. And to the best of our knowledge, other autopilots flew up to 6 to 8 meter per second wind. So this is what kept Jussi interested in our work. So, and he will have the wind parameters listed here pretty soon. And then it's a long movie. It's on our YouTube channel. You can definitely go. It's a 10-minute movie. We won't now go through the entire 10, but you see the stable photography where you don't get the feeling that it's taken from a small platform like this flying in large winds. Right, so here is now the parameters will come. Some, and then it goes into landing and different modes of variation. So see here it comes, a 10 to 12 meter per second wind. Let's just stop this on the YouTube channel you can see. There is this one here. I'm not sure if he will do this one. Let me show. He takes out one of these rotors and flies this hexa, which is here. So, and we have all these nice things to show thanks to him. So, After all those serious platforms, these toys are a lot of fun, right? We don't have a lot of stress here. There, if something crashes, we are in a stress. But here, basically, we are able to have some fun. Oh, okay.
All the team members.
Oh, I see. So not even by you, okay.
I can't take credit for that one.
Okay.
He's a brave man.
Okay, good. So L1 adaptive control lives in a lot of other systems as well. So whatever here is in yellow, it's already tested, flown. Whatever is not in yellow are simulations and papers, but there are different areas. So biological networks, anesthesia, so it's not limited to flight control systems. So it's in some boats of Raymarine. If you are interested, it's in Statoil. We'll have offshore testing soon, sometime. So hopefully before the end of this year. So what do we need to know? We need to know the boundaries of uncertainties that helps to set the filter bandwidth, and the CPU and the sensor noise characteristics that helps us to set the adaptive gain. So the performance limitations can be spelled out in hardware limitations. So the key is that the estimation loop is free of uncertainties, right? So we are estimating the uncertainty, but the estimation loop is kind of locked inside the controller that lets us to increase the estimation rates without losing robustness. The performance scales similar to linear systems. And the proofs are short and nice. So that's what helps to feel good about the things, right? So. And verification and validation can be done at reduced costs. If you remember in the beginning, I said for Boeing to flight test the X-36 aircraft, they had to do a few months of Monte Carlo to find the best adaptive gain for every flight condition. It's one thing to do the Monte Carlo to find the boundaries of stability. It's another thing to do it once to check a theoretically justified design. Of course, if we are going for NASA flights and so on, they still do Monte Carlo, but they do it to check what has been already provided as a theoretical guarantee. So with that, I would like to acknowledge my group of students who have worked very hard over the years. As I said, I give them all the credits. I take all the mistakes. So Enric Chargay was the one who basically flew into this stolen postal to provide a new proof for the pilots and system modeling ID people that a correctly designed feedback controller can help them to collect data from new territories yet unexplored. And we were very happy about those proofs. We have a lot of other students that have helped in various ways, but our main collaborators, to whom I give a lot of credit, were providing milestones in this development. So Cheng Yu Cao was from the beginning with me, laying out all the main proofs, main ideas in the beginning. He was the main support. Isaac Kaminer helped us with the UAV flights in Camp Roberts, California, doing a lot of coordinated maneuvers in these time-critical missions. He's done more than 300 flights on small UAVs. Irene Gregory was the key person at NASA facilitating the flight test, being always there, available for us, to make the connection with the right people, the right pilots, so that we are there on time. And of course, without sponsors' generous support, nothing would have worked. And since I talked so much of the coordinated flights, I would like to show this thing as fun. So this is two UAVs dancing tango. So this is just a lot of fun. And here, these are AR drones. They have no L1s. They are flying with Vicons inside the lab. They're coordinating over a network. And for coordination, I think they use L1 here for coordination objectives. So we hope today to be able to fly this with the platforms that Jussi would be providing for us outdoors. And this particular work got us the second place in a recent competition of EuroAccess in Washington, D.C. with the student. So the trajectories are coordinated with the song beat. So this was also a lot of fun to do all these things. So along the hard work with NASA airplanes, we have these fun projects that students enjoy playing very much with it. And with that, I'll let you see our website and the YouTube channel. Feel free to download movies there. And the key message that we learned while working even with the 5.5% model at NASA was that if there is no difference between theory and practice, in theory, there is big difference in practice. So thank you so much. I appreciate your attention, and I can take your questions now.
Thank you very much, Naira, for the very inspiring and pleasant talk. So I now would like to open the floor for questions. We have 5 to 10 minutes before the coffee will be ready, so please take your chance. Don't hesitate. Albert?
You said that you were constantly challenged by people at NASA. What I wonder is, how difficult were these challenges to meet? Because did it require any difference in the architecture of your control systems? Or was it adjustment of parameters? What was the main problem?
The main problem was this. So, okay. September was the first deployment, September 2010. We go there. It's the first deployment. NASA has told us our actuators will be 10 hertz bandwidth. Our delay between the ground station where the pilot is and the vehicle will be 50, 60 milliseconds. Bring a controller that would work for that. So you go with that. They do the deployment. The flight tests are poor. I didn't show those. Luckily, we did not crash. Then the flight test reveals that their model estimations and predictions were wrong. Their actuators were not 10 hertz, were 4 hertz. Their delay with the from the ground station to the airplane was not 50 milliseconds, but 120 or 150. So naturally, the CS that we had picked did not work with those. Luckily, it did not crash. So they go for an update of a model. They come back in November. Here is your revised model. The control software has to be locked in January 4 for the March deployment. November, you get the model, you work on it. Enric, the student whom I gave all the credit, was going home for Christmas break. He's a Barcelona guy. He had tickets to go home December 24 or what? December 20, right before Christmas, NASA sends a new model saying that the November model we shared is not the right one. This is the right one model. And if you want to fly in March, January 4, the software has to be here. A Barcelona guy cancels his trip home to stay there to fix so that January 4, we have the software locked so that they process it for 2 months for March deployment. It was that challenging. What else can I say? So and it was continuously like that. So whoever survived, it was more a survival. So, but Enric, I mean, he can just, I don't know, sleep with airplanes. He just loves those experiments, the challenges, and he loves to compete. He loves the challenges. He took it till the end. So it was challenging. And I say, you sit with 4 pilots a week, you get 10 different opinions. The same pilot tries the controller in the morning. He says, I want more damping in the short period. In the afternoon, he says, no, take it out. So it's like the driver, right? In the morning, you drive maybe more aggressively. In the evening, you drive more lazily back home. So we have different driving habits. Similarly, the pilots, during different times of the day, have a little bit different habits. And their opinions, I say, in between 4 pilots, there are 10 different opinions, and you have to pick the number that would do the best for all of them by the end. So we had 4 pilots working with us. And besides the 4 pilots, we had the NASA person, who was not the pilot to give the ratings, but he was giving us the prior insights because he knew it very well. He could handle it. He could fly it. He was giving us all his input, so we are ready for the 4 pilots. And, I mean, when the pilot is sitting there and trying the controller, in that room, nobody should breathe, okay? Once I entered and I accidentally said something, I was kicked out from that room forever, okay? So it's challenging environment, it's highly competitive. You sit there, they do the pilot gives the comment, you sit and write 4 or 5 hours nonstop. And I mean, I don't know, it's very challenging. Going to those runways, I went once or twice and I decided no more to go. You go there 6 a.m., you come back 8 p.m. and there is no bathroom there even. I mean, so it's hard. You have to get somebody to drive you outside to NASA base and come back. I mean, there are challenges. So, Yes. Is that enough?
Well, it sounds a very competitive environment.
Highly competitive. But, you know, students like to compete and be engaged and see their work being rewarded. And I think everybody should walk this mileage. It's an important experience. For people working in theory, it's very important to understand the role of the assumptions. For people who are more focused on practical engineering, it's a great opportunity to try these things because it shows you the real world. So, I mean, you have to face it, and it's very different from the academic setting. The rigor, the standards, and the books that NASA uses to pick the numbers and so on. It's hard work, very, very hard work.
Any other question? I think that this is one that you have received many times. I mean, at this point, after 6 years working on intensively on this, do you foresee any additional theoretical challenges in adaptive control?
Oh yeah, lot, of course, lot. It's still not done, right? Now, there are a lot of issues we're working on now. For example, on the level of this simple, like L1 setting, just main L1 theory, right now we're writing a dead zone paper, which is a very special dead zone. You can apply it with L1, you don't apply it with others. That helps with noise effects and so on to recover certain type of performance characteristics. There are a lot of challenges in output feedback, in filter selection, a lot of challenges. But these developments happen already at a much slower pace because the funding that we're getting is not coming to support the main L1 theory, but it comes for these human factors and how to couple the pilot input and here and there. So the funding that we're getting is not supporting the main L1 theory development, but it supports more this different human automation coupling, situation awareness, things like that. And in between, we are kind of also trying to develop whatever is missing theoretically to make it more complete, to make all these other more challenging problems easily solvable and so on. So there are a lot of challenges, right? We're happy to work with
you. Yeah, I mean, by working very...
I'm very interested in the data-driven adaptive control. In fact, today, after walking all these miles, I still think the true adaptation would be the data-driven one, not... This is more robustness. This is more a robust controller than adaptive. So that's my final conclusion, that we found just a different realization for a robust controller. That's all, and adaptive still has to be data-driven.
So the next challenge, to redesign the architecture based on data.
Well, right, to have the opportunity to be data-driven.
You said it was a very large time, quite large time delay for the communication, like around 15 milliseconds. But the algorithm was running on land, on board of the plane.
No, the controller is closed, the loop is closed on the ground. The controller runs in that truck, and it's sent wirelessly.
So the control signals were reaching the plane with a certain delay.
Right, and there was similarly delay in the opposite direction, right. And that was... Certain part of that delay you know, certain part you do not. Whatever we know, the beauty of L1 is whatever you know you can put into your predictor. That's the beauty of architecture. And I emphasized in the beginning that this is all about architecture. This is nothing else beyond architecture. So any delay you know, any saturation you know, anything you know about the system, you can put all of that into the predictor to minimize that error that's used for the estimation loss, okay? And anything you do not know, you would design your CS to compensate for part of the unknown still, okay? That's the beauty of it. And now what I refer to dead zone, so the dead zone modification, for example, from the saturation or delay modification is different in a sense that if for saturations and delays all the modifications are done at the input, dead zone modification is done at the output of the predictor. Therefore, theoretically, it's addressed differently. And right now, I mean, that paper will come out soon. So the opportunities that this architecture gives in terms of all these modifications, Today you go to flight test, you learn more about your system, you are able to bring it and put it into your predictor. Tomorrow you are able to make that predictor even better. So it gives you that opportunity to do this modification straightforwardly. Well, if you go for this other type of more or less equivalent robust controllers like IMC, disturbance observers, and so on, to accommodate those modifications, sometimes you need to recompute the system inverse with account of these non-linearities, which does not appear to be a straightforward task. So something like that. Within 2 minutes, that's the best answer I can give.
But is there any limitation about how long can be this time delay? Like if it's 10 seconds, you can put 10 seconds and still can control it, or it has to be within a certain minute?
10 seconds, you are talking a bit too much. Then you better do the L1 version for systems with delays. Right? There are systems that have delays. For example, for Schlumberger, we have worked with a model that had delays. We have developed L1 for systems with delays, but those were kind of a special delay rather than temporal. And you do a little bit differently. You do it for the delay. Okay, so you can design it for a system with delays, or if that delay is small but not so small that you would put it just, you would just count on your filter, you can put part of it into your predictor and minimize this trick. So as an architecture, it offers these flexibilities. That's what makes it easily applicable. So over the past 5-6 years, we've done so many applications. It's because it was easy to apply. That easiness comes with the architecture. So.
Yes. Well, I guess that then we can thank you once again, Naira, for the nice talk, and then we can have a short coffee break.
Thank you.
We will have 15 minutes. The coffee and some water is served upstairs, and then we can meet quickly here so that I can introduce Jussi Hermansen to everybody, and then we will have the flight demonstration outside. Yes. Thank you once again to Naira for the very inspiring talk, and I'm sure that many of us now know much more about her work and the possibilities relying on the application of her work. So now we move on with the program. As anticipated, we will have a live demonstration on another unmanned platform. The next point today, as I said, live demo, L1 adaptive flight controller for multi-rotor air vehicles. And the demo will be given by us, by Jussi Hermansen, with that is, I would say, a very eclectic guy. When I met him the first time and I heard about him, I expect to find a guy with an engineering background. Instead, I was surprised because his roots are completely in a different area. The guy was born as a journalist, graduated from the Danish School of Journalism in 2004, but here is the catch. He was born with a great interest in electronics and mechanics, and probably even a greater passion for radio-controlled vehicles. In 2007, as he likes to say, he caught the multi-rotor bug while building his first tricopter. And since then, multi-rotor piloting and control has been his passion and business. Since 2009, he's an active member of the AutoQuad project, for which he produces the electronics. In 2011, he established the company Viacopter or Viacopter. I guess it depends where you would like to put the accent, which produces a number of flight controllers and motor controllers. With more than 15 years of experience with radio control, Jussi is one of the most experienced multi-rotor pilots here in Denmark, and today is here to show us how an L1 adaptive flight controller will complement a skilled pilot towards the achievement of flying performances far from being reachable with standard PID-based autopilots. Please.
Thank you. So I'm a little bit outgunned here in terms of my college grade, so it's not going to be very theoretical, but I'll speak a little bit about the practical applications. Multi-rotor technology is a relatively new way, novel form of flying VTOL aircrafts. Technology was pioneered in the early part of this century by companies like Dragonflyer and Microcopter. Since then, in the beginning, the technology was very expensive. You'd have to expect to pay the same price as a small car for a professionally capable system. But that has all changed with a number of open source projects, and I'm part of one of those, it's the AutoQuad project, which is basically the brainchild of a very talented man called Bill Nesbitt, who wrote 99% of the code and designed the electronics. He was kind enough to give this as a gift to the world as open source, so we have been able to realize a very stable multi-rotor platform based on generic electronic components and some very well written and documented code. With the AutoQuad system, we can build what I describe as affordable VTOL multi-rotor systems. And in the beginning, it was a proportional PID controller we used, which is still the default option. But about 1.5 years ago, Bill and Naira and Srinath from Unmanned Dynamics began working on implementing the L1 controller in the AutoQuad system. And the big advantage I have found from a practical standpoint is that what L1 allows us to do is that once we have modeled the system and tuned the various control parameters, we are actually able to scale from something like this size, which is a small, which is the EduQuad platform, which we have designed for use in university laboratories for control theory studies and so on, to something like this, which is a 3.5 kilo platform we use for photogrammetry work, 3D mapping, so on, up to even bigger scale. We're working on a 7 kilo craft at the moment, which is to be used in professional film production, carrying what's a Red Epic production camera, which is a 3.5 kilo camera. And we expect to get the same stability as we know from the small platform and the medium to the big one. What I have found, and since I do not come from a mathematical and engineering background, my approach is very practical. So, and I have been learning from guys that know more about the theory than me. But in the process of getting acquainted with L1 in the AutoQuad platform, I have made several errors in setup. We of course do a model that describes the moment of inertia, the mass distribution on the frame, and the thrust and torque parameters of the propellers, which is something we need to be able to predict properly the states. What I found is that even when I introduced, not knowingly, but by error, introduced really big offsets in both the moment of inertia and the thrust calculations, we are still able to achieve a flying system even if we are way beyond the ideal model. For instance, for this craft, I made a simple error where I placed the payload at 40 centimeters in the model below the center of gravity, and I could still fly. And with this platform that is modeled for these propellers, I can take a completely different type of propeller, use the same thrust curve, and the adaptation will still allow me to fly. It won't be as stable as with the ideal model, but I have found that with L1 we have a huge envelope of error that we can introduce into the system and still stay relatively stable. Of course, there is always an ideal, and we are trying to get close to that. But the really amazing thing to me is that even when I unwillingly introduced great errors into the setup, I could still fly. And to me, that is a testament to the robustness of the L1 controller in an application like a multirotor. We have a very fast update rate. We have an inner loop going at 200 hertz, and sensor estimation at something like 1.8 kilohertz going on inside the system. And we have 1 kilohertz update of the actuators. So when combining that with L1, we get a super stable platform that is able to operate even on days like today, where traditional PID-based systems would either have to be tuned very specifically for operating on that day. I can go fly this today and it will perform exactly as it did yesterday when the wind was low. So for me, as a guy that does this practically, what I find is that with L1, I don't have to, as long as I get my models correct, my moment of inertia and thrust models correct, I can rely on the system performing equally well on a calm day and on a day like today. And for me as an operator, that's a huge advantage. I could, with the PID controller, tune very specifically for flying on a day like today and have another profile for flying on a calm day. But in practical terms, it gets hard to manage, because you will have to estimate constantly what is the conditions today and which profile do I think gets closest to the ideal situation today. And L1 eliminates that for me. So as I say, I'm outgunned in terms of my college grade here and my math and physics skills, but from the practical experience standpoint, I find that with L1, I get a system that performs predictably in any condition that is within the operations envelope. Today is on the limit for winds, especially for a small craft like this, because it's a question of mass and the ability to reject wind is somewhat a question of mass. So a bigger copter actually performs better in a high wind situation. But we can fly this today, and yes, I guess that's most of what I can say about the autoquad and the L1 adaptation. I think we'll just proceed to going outside, and I'll fly this small one. I am not allowed to fly the big one in places like this, because this is a city zone. So there are limitations on weight that I have to observe.
Yes, but then please, let's go out in front of the building.
Thank you. Unfortunately, the cable is... That's the problem.
This is the problem.
Yeah. I didn't know that it would go so far away.
Did you see the one I posted a few days?
little bit bright. Let's just unplug the cable and then unroll it.
That's...
Something like this with a standard battery will fly for 10 to 12 minutes, but in most cases it's a question of adding more milliamp hours on the battery. This system, like this, will take an extra payload of about 300 to 400 grams, and in theory you could just use 300 or 400 grams of extra battery and get around 20 minutes. But this is a good compromise about 750 grams as it is here, and it has a total thrust capacity of more than 2 kilos. So, but to play things safe and to not approach the limits of the envelope, we usually say that you operate at a maximum of about 60-70% of the total thrust capability in order to retain overhead for control. If you approach the envelope, the envelope max, you will lose stability simply because the actuators won't have enough overhead to stabilize and compensate. So, and on a little bit more calm day, I would have liked to demonstrate some of the more spectacular tricks, like throwing it around, but it's just not safe playing around with the. Even though it looks like a toy, these things will do serious damage when reaching contact with the human body.
Yeah.
Those two things don't mix.
Right.
So
don't mix well.
Don't mix well. They do mix.
they are actually flying lawnmowers. These very, very dangerous.
I actually have a video where I use one of these to trim a tree at home in my garden.
It does. Yes, I have one of them.
So, I mean, it's very interesting technology and very usable technology, but it also has to be approached with care, because
they are in essence spinning blades, and they're going at like 5,000 revolutions per minute. So they will inflict serious damage. There are examples of people losing fingers and getting cut up very severely from getting too close to these things. So, thank you.
Are these commercially available?
Yeah, this is a system that we develop
and sell. Stop recording.
Let's thanks once again, Jussi Hermansen from Quad-copter for the nice demonstration. It's been certainly very nice to see things in practice, not only on the nice videos of Naira, but also with our own eyes, so that we can bring it home and document to our business partners and the like. Now we proceed with the seminar. We move from the sky to the sea, and we will. The idea is to just provide you with a quick survey of the Danish L1 adaptive control experience. We will have two talks, one by me and one by another PhD candidate. Unfortunately, I don't have the same numbers of Naira yet, so it's not useful to show what I'm doing or what I'm not. I'm working on it, so it's better to go down to business instead of counting the publications. So, as I said, the Danish experience in L1 adaptive control, as is a best study case on the Unmanned high-speed watercraft. It is an activity that, together with Professor Mons Blanke, we have started a couple of years ago in collaboration with the drone section at the Naval Weapons School at the Danish Navy, that have been so kind to allow us to take this very nice toy and to do some fancy control on it. So the talk that I'm making right now is based on a previous talk done at the IFAC conference on maneuvering and control of marine craft last year, and is the artwork is of course due to two guys, Casper and Nils, that have been running their master project on this activity, and they have been able to produce in 6 months marvelous results, starting from scratch, identification of the system, up to full-scale implementation and validation of the L1 maneuvering control. So the outline, some motivation and challenges, the toy and the specs, some model complexity, identification. We will look briefly into the maneuvering controller based on L1 adaptive control theory, some simulation and full-scale validation, and then I will conclude with some remarks and research outlook before leaving the word to Lukas. So basically, why we want to play with those toys? Of course, we know why the Navy wants to play with those toys, but we need to find some other selling points. When doing research, whenever we think about personal watercraft, of course, the image that all of us have in mind is recreational activities. We are in a nice sunny beach with our girlfriend, and we decide to take one of those toys to have some fun for 20 minutes, half an hour. However, nowadays, there is a lot of focus on unmanned technology. We can think about removing the human from the loop. The vehicle, of course, can also be used for other activities like surveys, coastal surveys, search and rescue missions. Of course, the Navy is very much interested in order to train their weapon systems, so that's where everything has originated. However, when we want to operate vehicles like these ones in an unmanned fashion, we of course, we need to always make sure that we can perform the tasks safely and in a reliable manner, because this is a vehicle that has a speed envelope from 2 to 30 meters per second, and the change in speed from min to max takes place in few seconds. So we need to make sure that whenever we want to operate the vehicle in an unmanned fashion, we know exactly what is going to happen, no matter in which range of velocities we use. So seaworthiness, of course, is a major requirement. The challenge is that we have met when that the guys have met and has as mentors we've met in working with this class of vehicles. Basically, they all rely on modeling and dynamic stability issues. Planing craft, in literature, they are known for suffering or porpoising, bow diving, difficulty of course keeping, etc. Because by increasing the speed, we reduce the amount of surfaces in contact with water. And of course, we start also jumping in and out of water whenever we meet waves. So the dynamics of the vehicle changes a lot from the low speed range to the high speed range. And also, it is strongly affected by the environmental condition. So here, of course, we have a trade-off between safety of the personal watercraft and of its mission is strictly related to what kind of maneuvering capabilities we can enforce into our system through control design. So if we look at the maneuvering problem, what kind of more specific challenges do we have? Well, it is well known from towing tank tests that the maneuvering characteristics are strongly influenced by the vertical dynamics. Differently from fully displaced vessels, where whenever we want to design a maneuvering controller, it doesn't really matter if we consider or not the even pitch. For these kind of vehicles, increasing the speed, we go from fully displaced to planing craft. So of course, the vertical oscillations and the vertical motions are affecting the maneuvering capabilities. So here we can see three specific examples. At low speed, basically, we will have that the PWC is like any fully displaced vessel. So, of course, it will have some maneuvering characteristics. From medium to high speed, part of the hull starts being exposed, so to say, out of water, and the maneuvering characteristic, of course, changes. In this configuration, basically, we go from a vehicle that is meant to be in contact with water to something that for at least a fraction of time is flying through air. So, of course, when we think about maneuvering and doing maneuvering control design model-based, the first question we need to answer is which models are we going to address? What kind of complexity are we seeking for? Should we address all the modeling spectrum, so to say, into very complex nonlinear model, or we can assume or we can work with simplified models and then shift, so to say, the challenges deriving from the different behavior towards the control design. And this basically is the approach that we have chosen, of course, also on the base of being aware of the good results that Professor Hovakimyan got with the L1 adaptive control. We decided, okay, this resembles, it seems to be a very good study case in order to apply this theory. So, of course, our control objective is the first point. We want to operate the high-speed personal watercraft with equal performance across the craft's full envelope of operation. Based on this objective, we say, okay, modeling-wise, let's treat the watercraft as a fully displaced vessel. Let's go back to standard maneuvering theory for marine vessels, for marine craft, and let's do the modeling there. So we went for a reduced complexity model, 4 degrees of freedom starts with your role model, and then the 1 degree of freedom your model for designing the steering controller. And in order to, so to say, get the models up and running, of course, we have faced another challenge. How do we identify the parameters? Well, the toy is too big to be placed in a towing tank. And at the same time, whenever you put it at sea, it's suffering a lot, the wave motion, also the small waves, what you will consider small waves, because the dimension of the watercraft is comparable to what we consider to be small. But nevertheless, our only chance was to do full-scale identification. So we sent our student out at the Danish Navy base at Sjællandsodde to do some tests and collect data in order to identify the maneuvering model. On the other hand, whatever wasn't captured in the, so to say, standard maneuvering models has been addressed through the control design, designing a So basically, with the idea of designing a robust adaptive maneuvering controller capable of dealing with rapid and large changes in the dynamics of the vehicle. So this is the vehicle itself. In this case, we have one of the sea trials that the students have done in order to collect data for identification. Here, in this case, is remotely controlled by the operator at the Navy. These are the specification of the water jet. It's a commercial vehicle modified by the Navy in order to be remotely operated. It's almost 3.5 meters long. It has a dry weight of almost 400 kilos and has certainly a very large engine power. How it is actuated, we have one servo for throttle control, one servo for controlling the azimuth angle of the propulsion system. So we can, of course, change the direction where we throw out the water. And then we have also another servo for controlling the elevator angle of the blade. Here there is a kind of shield that can be put in front of the nozzle in order basically to do reverse maneuvering. That is the topic of the talk of Lukas. One thing to be noticed here is that we obviously actuate the servos through PWM signals, and we have no feedback from the servos themselves. On the communication side, we have a radio receiver for remote control, and then, of course, we have equipped the system with a GPS and a 9 degree of freedom IMU in order to know what the system is doing. So the modeling has been the first part. We have, as I said, we have done modeling according to the standard literature, 4 degrees of freedom model by Blanke and Christensen from 1993 that is widely used in the area. Here we have the general kinetic equation of motion of the vehicle. We have the mass times the acceleration plus Coriolis, centripetal forces and damping forces. Then we have gravitational and buoyancy, and then we have the actuators and the environmental forces. Unfortunately for us, since we were performing identification on full-scale motion data, it's not possible to identify the elements of the mass matrix, the elements of the damping matrix, and so on and so forth, because we have no access to measuring the forces that are acting on the vehicle. So the best we can identify is basically the, so to say, the mixed coefficients of the system dynamics. So what we did, of course, is to assume that the environmental forces are equal to zero, and then by measuring the velocities and the acceleration, the angular velocities and the linear acceleration, and knowing what we command, of course, we can carry out some identification of this system. The first problem we have addressed is the surge dynamics that usually maneuvering is considered to, can be considered to be decoupled from the steering part. Here, of course, we want to identify the linear and quadratic damping. And in the first place, we have left out all the terms that determine some dynamical contribution whenever we make a turning maneuver. Another challenge here has been the modeling of the thrust, since the general way of modeling this term for us wasn't suitable, since we didn't measure the shaft speed, but the only knowledge we had was basically the handle command that is, so to say, a real variable between 1 and 7. So in this term, we had to find a new mapping in order to, so to say, establish a mapping from what we can command and what the water jet delivers in order to put the system in motion. So the identification of the surge dynamics has been rather straightforward, I would say. We have assumed to have a straight course in calm weather at a certain point in time. We simply assume that we, so to say, we put the thrust to zero, and then we will have that the thrust dynamics has to follow a classical decaying exponential behavior. What we can do is to take a first test. Here we have a step down of handle command from level 4 to level 1, and we have identified through nonlinear least square methods the parameters, alpha 1 and alpha 2, and then here we can see in validation that when we step down from level 7 to basically from full speed to idle state, we still have a good fitting of our model towards the against the real data. However, when we have validated the model on positive and negative variations, we have realized that, as could also be expected from the beginning, that of course the model is capable of following very nicely the downwards step, but we were a bit too fast on the upwards steps. So the idea has been to do some empirics tuning, some empirical tuning by introducing an empirical variable k that could modulate how much the time constant should be in order to get the best of the fit both in the upwards and in the downwards step command. Similar approaches have been utilized for the identification of the steering dynamics. Here we have used a mixed approach. First, black box identification to get the initial values of the parameter, and then through the physical insight that we have of the system, like that the signage of this damping coefficient must be negative, the restoring force in a roll must be also negative, we could run a gray box identification to, so to say, get to the real or to the most probable value of the coefficients for the dynamics of the steering. Here we can see the results of this identification based on a 50-90 zigzag test. We can see that both the sway, the turning rate and the turning angle are very nicely identified. Also the roll angle, the part of the system that is not so nicely identified is the roll rate, but roll in general is also the most non-linear mode for any kind of marine craft. So, of course, their linear models are very challenged in order to provide good identification. Once we had the model, now we had to now address the control part. And, of course, it's important to be able to answer some basic questions. Why do we need an adaptive controller? Well, in our case, many limitations in modeling came up. As we have seen, both surge and steering appear to be dependent on the running attitude. This we have seen by doing several tests at different speeds. Forward speed has a substantial influence on the steering characteristics. We have seen that the surge dynamics shows different behaviors during positive and negative accelerations. At the identification stage, of course, we have this tuning parameter, but control-wise, we would like to be able to do things without, so to say, tricks. And then we have constraining the modeling of the steering dynamics. On the horizontal plane, naturally exclude the effect of the vertical motions. We knew in advance from literature survey that plays a strong role into the dynamics of the vehicle. So this called in for an L1 adaptive maneuvering control. We have designed two independent L1 controller, one for cruise control and one for steering control. Here we have been playing very basic. Naira certainly will spot us immediately. We have been using her theory, in this case for the surge dynamics, for designing an L1 adaptive controller for system with nonlinear behaviors. The architecture is, in this respect, very standard. We have a state predictor, we have the parameter estimator using continuous time, using the projection operator to guarantee boundedness of the estimates. And then we have a control law that uses this, the feedback because of the nonlinear behavior around the filter D of S. And here, if I well remember, we have started the analysis with a simple first order system to keep it simple and to also for the students to get a good understanding of what is going on without, so to say, putting too much complexity and losing track on who does what in the architecture. A similar design has been done for the steering controller, relying, of course, on the available theory. Here we can see what we mean by scalable transient behavior. Here, basically, for the cruise controller, we have done a sequence of steps, a staircase going from the minimum allowable speed, around 2.5 meters per second, up to almost 30 meters per second. And we can see that with the exception of the last step, where basically we eat the saturation of the available thrust, basically the step response always looks the same from one condition, velocity condition, to the next one. The steering controller has also predictable responses. We can see what it is expected, that the response has a small phase lag that is introduced by the filter that we have in the architecture. But nevertheless, the heading is capable to follow the reference heading very nicely. And this is, so to say, the end of my talk. Here, the guys at the end of the project were capable of implementing the full-scale L1 adaptive controller, and they've been back at the Danish naval base. And here we can see that first vehicle will perform at quite high speed, a square path, and then at the end of the square, it will basically ramp up over the entire range of available speed. And here we can see the robustness and the stability of the controller. The vehicle certainly changes its dynamic characteristics by being displaced to jumping in and out of water. Nevertheless, whenever the vehicle re-enters in contact with water, the controller is still there doing its job for us and making sure that we are able to follow the track. And now we can see that the PWC speeds up to full throttle with no problem. I hope that it is visible, because from here it seems that there is quite a bit of light on the screen. So here are some of the data we brought back from the full-scale validation. On the top, we have the cruise controller, where we have changes in step on the reference. And we can see that, of course, the data when we go out there are always more noisy than when we play our simulations. But nevertheless, we are able, the controller does his job. We can see, for example, by comparing this step response, where we are not strongly affected in the transit by the noise, with this one, that basically we have this scalability of transient behavior. And we can also see that the thrust necessary in this case was also always below the maximum available thrust. Let's go back. And the same we can see for the steering controller, that we are able to do step changes, heading changes in a very nice way. Of course, a lot of work can still be done. This was just the first step towards implementing this L1 adaptive controller. But some results, of course, have been put in place. We have now a model, a maneuvering model for the vehicle that can be used for further studies. We have been exploited some of the potential in L1 adaptive control. Many other things, as I said, can be done to design the two controllers together, for example. That could be a possibility. But at least it was nice to see that when we went out at sea, what we experienced on the paper, on our simulation, was reflected also in real life. Some places where you can find some more detailed results. And the research outlook for this activity that we have with the Navy, of course, to enhance some robust autonomy through integration of smart sensors. In this sense, we have a master project that is getting to an end in a week or so. Otherwise, Mons and I, we will put an end on it, asking the guy to deliver. But he's on the right track. He's busy writing his report. We have been started working on station keeping, and certainly there is something more to do there. As I said, in integrated design of the maneuvering controller, where the autopilot is seen as a multivariable control problem, and then also to address some of these well-known dynamical issues that planning craft suffer from, eventually within the L1 framework or also with other control techniques. Thank you for your attention. If you have questions, I'm here for them. Otherwise, we can move on with Lukas.
Can we get your slide?
Yes, yeah, of course. That you will get everything from today. Don't worry. Yes, you can borrow everything. Yes, and the Navy is here with us today, and he has already sent me an email that we can share with you the movies on YouTube, and so you will get the link and everything. This has to be plugged in.
And you said you wrote the district time L1?
Now we will have a case with Lukas where we have approached the design directly in discrete time.
Therefore it's interesting.
In a... Here we have is a study case, of course, but we are certainly interested in looking on how to frame it in the theoretical sense, because at least in the previous study where we have implemented, of course, we have succeeded in doing so. But I believe that, for example, when we have an uncertain input gain and we go from continuous time design and we want to discretize, of course, in a system where you have a hard limitation in sampling time, for example, in marine application, 20 years or the like, or even less, actually this flexibility of having, the bandwidth of the filter as large as you like is not really feasible. And actually it's the sampling time imposing the first theoretical limitation in there. But yes, our last speaker is Lukas Theisen, that has recently started as a PhD student at Automation and Control here at the Department of Electrical Engineering. The topic of his talk is based on his own sweat on the master project that came as a natural continuation of the activities of the previous one. Now Lukas is we brought him away from these exciting toys and we shift him on other activities in collaboration with the mechanical department, where he's also running a very interesting PhD project where he will be required to do a lot of experimental work as well. So Lukas, please.
Thank you for the presentation. This presentation, Unmanned Watercraft Identification and Adaptive Control in Low Speed and Reversing Regions, it was presented in September at the 9th IFAC conference in Control Applications in Marine Systems. And one of the questions I got there from one of the from one in the audience was, "Have you presented this to Naira?" And I just had been informed that I was going here today, so luckily I could say, "Well, I haven't yet, but I will get the opportunity to now today." So. The presentation will cover this a brief motivation for the project. I'll go through the modeling of the water jet craft from full-scale sea trial data. We will go through the adaptive controller design, combining a baseline PD controller with a non-adaptive wave filter and an L1 adaptive augmentation. And I will show, I'll go through a robustness analysis, and finally we'll get to some of the results, simulational results we have with this. So as Roberto already mentioned, these personal watercrafts are capable of very fast maneuvering and agile maneuvering, and it makes them suitable for these very complex missions. And in these missions, station keeping will certainly be a required feature. And this is a challenge due to the under-actuation of these vehicles. We can only steer in two directions while we're trying to control three in three dimensions. We have no model of this vehicle readily available at these conditions during this project, and this therefore had to be done from the full-scale sea trials, which is of course always a challenge due to disturbances from waves and wind, etc. The found parameters that we have identified are uncertain, and this calls for adaptive control. So we have proposed this controller design, which adapts to uncertain parameters and allows us to limit the control response towards high frequency wave induced motion. Briefly about this watercraft, Roberto went through some of it. We are able to steer this watercraft horizontally by an azimuth deflection delta, and we have this blade that we can rotate down in front of the water jet, and this elevator deflection we call beta. A deflection beta corresponds to a water jet output with direction 2 beta. So this gives some interesting configurations. For example, we can direct our water jet vertically, which actually gives us no control opportunities at all. The experiments, the search we have identified, here we see one of the data sets that we used for identification and one used for validation. During this maneuver, we stepped this shield down in front of the water jet and observed the vehicle going from forwards to reversing. And as you see, the measured data in blue matches nicely with the identified model response shown in green, and similarly for the validation data set. However, when we get to the turning dynamics, the yaw dynamics, we get more complicated results due to the wave-induced motion. So what we see is 6 of the 19 data sets here used, and the measured response is shown in blue. As you can see, it's very heavily affected by wave motion. So when we use this for identification, I forgot to mention, we have done these experiments at different constant elevator deflections to show the behavior as a function of this deflection. When we have done this over this these different elevator deflections, we get something where we see the gain constants using this first order Nomoto model with wave disturbances. This gives us a gain k and a time constant t to estimate. And seeing this, we see the gain k is inconsistent in the sense that experiments performed at the same conditions do not give the same gain estimate. The same can be said for the, this is the time constant, this is the gain k. The same can be said for the gain, there is some uncertainty here. It's also interesting to see that these data sets were carried out while the vehicle is moving forwards, whereas these data sets come from when the vehicle is actually reversing due to this shovel being down in front of the water jet. And the sign of the gain changes when the vehicle begins to reverse. So for adaptive control, we need to at least know the sign of our input gain. And therefore, we have determined a new gain being the yaw acceleration due to this deflection. This is then estimated based on these measurements, and it is therefore also uncertain, as we see. this is, of course, including the plus minus one sigma confidence intervals. When we then model this in discrete time, we choose our states being the heading error, being the reference heading that we want to have minus the current heading, and the yaw rate, which is the speed with which we are turning. We can then get this discrete time model, where this is the standard system matrix, our gain matrix with an uncertain gain omega, our input u being this yaw acceleration, f being a term modeling these unmodeled dynamics of cross couplings between the surge and the sway dynamics of the vehicle, and rw being the wave disturbances and wind disturbances. We then get these system matrices. I don't want to spend too much time going through these. We then want to design this controller that's able to steer our vehicle in presence of these disturbances and model uncertainties. And the way this is done is a three-step. So first we choose a nominal set of dynamics, design a PD controller for this. We augment our system with a wave filter to limit our control actuation towards waves. And we then augment this with a discrete time L1 adaptive controller. So, like I said, we choose a set of nominal dynamics, a nominal gain K, N0, and nominal time constant. We design a PD controller for this, which gives us this system, where we have the yaw rate dynamics, nominal yaw rate dynamics, the heading of our vehicle being the integral of the yaw rate, This is then fed back through the PD controller along with the measured yaw rate, which gives our PD feedback. The wave filter that we then want to have is inserted to limit the response towards high frequency disturbances. It has this form being a third order filter, where this is a notch filter giving a frequency drop around the main wave frequency. This part being a low pass filter that limits our high frequency wave frequency actuation. So this is then the response of our wave filter along with the response of just the baseline PD controller. And this is then when we insert the wave filter, being the transfer function from control signal to, sorry, from wave disturbance to control signal. This is our a transfer function of our heading reference to the actual heading of the vehicle. Then we get to the L1 adaptive augmentation, where we have used the fact that the main uncertainty is in the yaw rate dynamics here. There is an uncertainty in the dynamics from yaw rate to yaw. This is an integrator, so we have reduced the complexity of our controller with this. So going through the controller, we have the yaw dynamics here, our PD controller with the wave filter. We get to the L1 adaptive augmentation, again consisting of a state predictor, predicting determining the dynamics of our reference model. We have the disturbance parameter estimate and our control law, which in this case reduces to a low pass filter. This disturbance estimate gain in this case is sampling time dependent, so a very high sampling frequency gives us a large gain, so there is a trade-off there. We choose a sufficiently low sampling time, also being within what is realistic of the sensors that we have available. We chose 0.1 seconds. The control law reduces to this low-pass filtering, where the low-pass filter that we use is a second-order low-pass filter with unity DC gain and sufficiently damped poles. This is how it will look in discrete time. And we then did a robustness analysis of this control system, where we took our system, calculate the transfer functions from the heading reference to the actual heading and from the disturbance input to the control signal output. We then calculated these transfer functions with this common denominator and evaluated this for a perturbed system, where we consider a gain that's 3 times larger than the nominal gain that we have. When we do that, we get this result of the transfer function from heading reference to heading. So what we see is and we of course evaluated this for different bandwidths of our low pass filter C. So increasing the bandwidth of this low pass filter, we see that we approach the nominal dynamics better and better. But at the same time, we also increase our gain from disturbance to controller, as we see in this graph. So this sets a trade-off between having agile adaptation on one hand and this desire not to waste too much energy on counteracting high-frequency wave motion. As I just stated, we then did some simulations where we showed the uniform response here while moving forwards, a scalable transient response until we reach the saturation of our actuator. In the largest case, we still maintain this nice behavior of our system. We can control the vehicle both while moving forwards and when we flip this shovel down in front, or blade down in front of the water jet, we are still able to control our system with a uniform transient. When we then induce some wave motion, we also maintain our heading in spite of these waves of approximately 0.5 meters. This is a lot compared to when we use this water jet vehicle. And we do this without overloading the actuator. We see that we only reach the saturation, the blue point, the being the applied control signal, we only reach saturation at one point, and we stay within the rate limits of our system. So to conclude, we have identified this steering model of the water jet craft at the low speed regions used for this station keeping controller. This showed a large parameter variation due to the disturbances that we have in our system. We then designed this discrete time L1 adaptive controller, which combines a baseline PD controller with a discrete time L1 adaptive controller and this wave filter, and we have reduced the complexity knowing this fact about our system. We performed this robustness analysis showing a trade-off on one hand between agile adaptation and on the other hand between response to undesired response towards waves. As I said earlier, this was presented at the 9th IFAC conference on control applications in marine systems in Osaka, Japan. And related research can be found here. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions, comments are always welcome. Critics as well. Yes? We have an experienced professor in marine dynamics there that now.
I tried to move the wave filter into the sea of S. I would try to move the wave filter out of a nominal model into the COS filter.
The
so you can have a notch in the COS.
Yeah, we haven't tried that, no, but that is an interesting opportunity.
Well, then you get a wave filter working also on the adaptive part.
Mm. Yeah, I see your point. So this we can consider.
Yes. Okay, but thanks you very much once again. Well, impressively we managed to finish on schedule. So I would like to thank you everybody for being here with us today. First place, thank you once again to Professor Hovakimyan for coming all the way from US and giving an inspiring lecture. Thanks to Jussi Hermansen for showing us the capabilities of L1 on these multi-rotor systems. And thank you once again to all of you for enjoying this day with us. Now there is upstairs a light refreshment that will allow us to stay a bit together, to mingle and socialize. Thanks to everybody.